the podcast. We are here live. It's been a long time since I've been here doing a show, and we've got an interesting show tonight with technical difficulties always. But we're going to get right into it. Today's show is going to be about William Billy Strayhorn, and some of you probably have never heard of William Billy Strayhorn, a.k.a. Sweet Pea, a.k.a. Strays. He was an arranger, composer, lyricist, pianist, and innovator. Innovator of the modern music. Some people don't know about that, and we're going to discuss that. And also a civil rights supporter of Dr. Martin Luther King. Still don't know who he is? Well, he was also known for his collaboration, questionable collaboration, with Duke Ellington, of where Strayhorn began and Duke ended, or did it? And we're going to talk about that too. He's virtually unknown to the jazz public, known by musicians, singers, dancers, theater, movie people. They know about Strayhorn. But he never got the notoriety or royalties for the music he composed and arranged with Duke Ellington, such as Lush Life, Take the A-Train, Something to Live For, Passion Flower, and Satin Doll. Some people question if this young man ever did any of this. And he wrote this music as a young man, by the way. Strayhorn was born September 29th. 1915 in Dayton, Ohio, and raised in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania as a child, and spent his summers with his grandmother, who introduced him to music, playing the piano, and she encouraged him to play the piano. He pursued it and wanted to become a classical musician. He was interested in European music, wanted to be a composer, a pianist, as I've said. And while at Westinghouse High School, he wrote his first waltz. And when he graduated that same year in 1934, Strayhorn pursued by applying to many schools of trying to get into classical music in 1934. And it wasn't happening. It didn't happen, such as what Nina Simone would experience years later, and still happens today. But when applying for schools, it didn't work out, so he went right to work at a drugstore, you know, being a delivery person and doing ice cream sodas and, you know, sitting there writing music, you know, studying music, and even returned to his high school. He wrote a musical, Fantastic Rhythms, by in My Little Brown Book, later recorded by Ellington, Duke Ellington. We'll talk about that. And you know, as I said, classical music was what he really wanted to do. Strayhorn wanted to emulate composers Stravinsky and Ravel, but he also admired Duke Ellington as well. You know, he knew Ellington's reputation. And being that Strayhorn was introduced to jazz, you know, he enjoyed the freedom of the music. And by the way, he can get an income. Okay, Strayhorn's philosophy were the four freedoms: freedom from hate, freedom from self-pity, freedom from the fear of possibly helping someone, and, you know, that wouldn't possibly help you. That's a lot to take. Mr. Strayhorn, growing up as a young man, was an incredible dresser, was tailored, black rimmed glasses, you know, some of the styles that would work today even, okay? And was always clean. Another thing about Billy, he just happened to be gay. He was a small, black brother, intelligent, very intelligent, but he was gay. He also wrote a tune at age 16 that was called Lush Life. Now, Lush Life could be someone that's getting drunk all the time, or, you know, but the lyrics were sort of like that. But at age 16, he wrote this fantastic tune, okay? So Strayhorn, you know, pursuing what he wanted to do, and at the same time doing classical pieces and writing music. And he also formed a trio called the an interracial group, which was unheard of at that time in Pittsburgh, you know, playing jazz, called the Mad Hatters. You know, so, you know, he had names, man. This cat, this young brother, was doing things. and was not going to be stopped. All right, Lush Life, which is a tune that's been recorded by Nat King Cole, Nancy Wilson, Frank Sinatra, Queen Latifah, Lady Gaga, and the most famous recording was Johnny Hartman and John Coltrane. Still don't know this guy? Well, you're starting to get it. Strayhorn was young. He had drive and imagination and an ambition to pursue his dreams despite everything. And also, as I said, you know, being in the jazz world, which he had to pursue, being gay and theatrical music was a big no-no, man. You know, you're stepping in the world of macho music, okay? So finally, you know, all these years later, he's out of high school, you know, a friend of one of his relatives gets him to meet Duke Ellington, who happens to be coming to Pittsburgh at the Stanley Theater, which was sort of like the Apollo for Pittsburgh, December 1st, 1938. So Strayhorn gets the audition, comes up there, and plays one of Duke Ellington's tunes called Sophisticated Lady. And Duke played it just like Ellington, note for note, okay? And then Strayhorn turns around, because Ellington was at this time just laying down, just listening, you know, not paying too much attention, but when he heard him do this, he said, whoa. And then Strayhorn turned around and said, hey, this is how I would play. So he changes the arrangement completely, you know, and makes it his. So now he's got Duke's attention. Ellington is up. He's got some of the band members to, hey, listen to this kid, what he's playing. You know, he's only 23 years old. And Ellington, he plays Solitude, and Ellington immediately says, you know, this is a boy genius, okay? He recognizes talent. So Ellington is sold on Strayhorn and says, listen, you need to come to Harlem, join my organization. And so Strayhorn at first didn't want to do it, but he said, hey, you know what? Let's take the chance. He's never really been outside of Pennsylvania except going to his grandma. You know, so Strayhorn moved to New York in 1939 at 23 years old. Ellington is 39, and so the musical relationship began with no contract. Strayhorn was so excited about the directions that Ellington gave him. Duke said, "Listen, come here, you know, come to Harlem, take the A train," and you know what happened next. So excited about the directions, he writes a tune called Take the A Train. Now, Take the A Train, written by this 23-year-old young man, becomes an Ellington standard. And when he first arrives to New York in Harlem, he's living in the YMCA. Ellington immediately takes him and says, listen, you need to come up here, live where I am in my house, take one of the rooms with his family. And Strayhorn moves up to Sugar Hill, which is the place where all the doctors, the celebrities, lawyers, businessmen, if you got money, you lived in Sugar Hill. So this works perfectly for Strayhorn, okay? So Strayhorn is now up there. And now it's 1941, and I'm jumping ahead, but this is where Strayhorn's reputation really grows. It's during the 1940-1941 ASCAP strike. And some of you might say, what is ASCAP? The American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers. This strike takes place, all right? And all union members, which is Ellington's band, cannot play on the radio. They can't make any money. They can't even play in a club, you know, nowhere, because that's what ASCAP stands for. Fees, licensing, where you can play, all that. Strayhorn wasn't a member. So he composes a string of tunes, okay, for Ellington. And so they can continue to play on the radio. The tunes that he writes are a cutting edge and later adopted by the post-bop era, which we'll go into next. Strays gets an award as an arranger, but no credit. Ellington puts it under his company, Tempo. All right. So also during the 1940s, during this time, Strayhorn is going to Minton's, all right? Minton's Playhouse in Harlem. And this is where, you know, he meets Dizzy Gillespie, Thelonious Monk, Max Roach, Bud Powell. You know, he meets all these cats up there. And Strays is interested in bebop, you know, and what's doing. So Strayhorn would play his music and also would contest Monk and Bud Powell. And drummer Max Roach said that when Billy Strayhorn was on, no one wanted to go on after him because he would just blow the competition away. Strayhorn's cutting edge arrangements and compositions that he would write would bridge the gap for the big band, bop, and post-bop music, a.k.a. cool music, that Miles Davis would also follow 20 years later. That's how far ahead Strayhorn was. This is a fact that Strayhorn contributed and developed the modern music and was acknowledged by Charlie Parker, Dizzy, and Monk, who were, you know, wanted to listen to what Strayhorn was doing, you know, where he was going. So this Strayhorn was a virtuoso. He was an innovator, and many do not know that Strays, you know, this is not, you know, I found this out, you know, that Strayhorn was part of the modern music or bebop development. Okay, so now, you know, Strayhorn finally, you know, not getting any recognition, no credit. He says, listen, I got to leave this guy, you know, Ellington, go out on my own, get his own place and everything. And this is mid-1950s, finally leaves Strayhorn. And Strayhorn develops a reputation of, you know, Orson Welles, you know, the director, actor, you know, way ahead kind of guy in Hollywood, wants Strayhorn. And he writes musicals for him, such as Faust, another musical, which I forgot the name of. But this is in France. He writes over in France. He does compositions, songs, and tunes, and there's an album for Rosemary Clooney, mother of George Clooney, Nat King Cole, Billy Eckstein, Johnny Hodges, and his album. And at the same time, Strayhorn is even putting out some of his own stuff, his own trio. And of course, as I said, you know, leaving Ellington was the best thing that ever happened. Okay, so now, you know, Strayhorn is, you know, suddenly developing his own avenue of success. You know, but Duke would still reach out, you know, and he, you know, there was a movie that he was doing called Anatomy of a Murder, which you can look up, which was says by Duke Ellington, but he would actually call up Billy Strayhorn and he would say, you know, William, you know, Strays, how would you do this? Blah, 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 blah. And Strays, they said, you know, this is going off a conversation in a book, which is called Strayhorn Illustrated Life, which, by the way, I'm going to tell you about, too. And, you know, he would say, you know, well, how would you do this? How would you do that? And Strayhorn would direct him on how to write, staying up way up early in the morning of how to compose the music for this movie, Anatomy of a Murder. Now, he also did another musical that was assigned to Duke Ellington. But Ellington would, you know, commission it off and say, listen, do this musical. And the musical was Beggar's Holiday. It was assigned to Duke, but Strayhorn did it, yet didn't receive the credit. I mean, this was the kind of thing that was going on. And many times this was going on too because of Duke's people, okay? The media wouldn't accept a short, gay, black man that could possibly be the guy that was writing all this music for Strayhorn. I mean, for Ellington, all right? And then, you know, there was even the controversy of the song, the tune called Satin Doll. The lyrics and everything were written by Billy Strayhorn. But Ellington claimed he wrote it for Mrs. Ellington. And Strayhorn said that was the name that he gave to his mother, Satin Doll. So this gives you an idea. And this is even happening today, okay? Another thing about Strayhorn, he was doing a lot of things out in Harlem, getting part of the society of people out there, you know, elitists, musicians, politicians. He was part of a group called the Copacetics, a musical society, that was formed because of William Bojangles Robinson, a famous dancer and actor, most notably doing movies with Shirley Temple, look her up, okay, and everything. So, you know, Copacetics were known because Bill Robinson would always say everything is copacetic. And I remember growing up in the 60s, you know, or early 70s here in Kansas, everything's copacetic. You know, everything's cool, everything's together. And, you know, this is the kind of mood that was going on with the copacetic. As a social group, they held fundraisers and parties, and everyone wanted to go to their parties. And their parties, you know, drew, you know, all the celebrities, you know, Miles Davis, Willie Mays, Martin Luther King. They would dress in these captain's hats and blue blazers and get on a yacht and with his close friend Lena Horne, who he also helped, Lena Horne, by the way, in her career in singing as well, you know, lyrics and interpreting, and saved her career, matter of fact. You know, I mean, Strayhorn was known, okay? And he also had a philosophy that he got from this composer, this European composer called Rimsky-Korsakov. And it was said that what he said was Rimsky-Korsakov's philosophy was all parts should lie easily under the fingers. This is how music should be developed. And this is the rule that Strayhorn also went by. That's his first rule, to write something, you know, his first rule was to write something that a guy can play. And this is why he was so beloved by so many musicians, singers, dancers, the whole theater and musical world. But Strayhorn was obscured by Ellington, and no recognition to the jazz public about what this man was doing. Being black and gay led to heavy drinking, depressions, you know, being depressed, and smoking, okay, which would lead to his, you know, bad health and death at cancer. He would die of cancer, and even wrote his final tune called Blood Count. Okay, he died May 31st, 1967, at age 51. But he, as I said, he was revered by musicians, filmmakers, and dancers and singers in the theater world. Strayhorn, is my whole thing is, if you don't know who Billy Strayhorn is, now you know. Billy Strayhorn should be recognized and compared to Gershwin in musical compositions, songs, and musicals, as well as the modern music and jazz. And if you don't know, as I said, now you know. A funny thing, you know, I'll leave you with this about Billy Strayhorn. Strayhorn, you know, as I go here and click, Strayhorn, you know, I thought about something. I said, you know, I guess Strayhorn died with no money or anything like that. And it was quite the opposite. After all that had been going, he had been going through, he ended up, you know, worth $2 to $5 million. And Duke Ellington's net worth at his passing was $4 million, okay? I guess things even out. Just Coolin' the podcast. I'm Tony Bellamy. Hopefully you enjoyed the show. Till the next time, it's been real, and you've been most regular. Thank you. Used to be there, you could see where they'd been washed away by 2 minutes through the day, 12 o'clock tales. Then you came along with your siren song to tempt me to madness. I thought for a while. Hi, this is Tony Bellamy. Welcome to Just Cool, where hip hop meets beat. Was tinged with the sound and the many flavors of jazz. Just Coolin' the podcast. We are here live.
It's been a long time since I've been here doing the show. We've got an interesting show tonight with technical difficulties always. But we're going to get right into it. Today's show is going to be about William Billy Strayhorn. And some of you probably have never heard of William Strayhorn, a.k.a. Sweepy, a.k.a. Strays. He was an arranger, composer, lyricist, pianist, and everything.